Hey guys, and welcome to Crime Scene Reconstruction using Blood Spatter Pattern Analysis. If you can find a single drop of blood at a crime scene, that can go a long way. From a single drop of blood, you can determine the type of surface the blood drop landed on, the direction it was traveling when it hit the ground or hit the wall, how far off the ground was the source of blood, the angle at which it hit the ground or hit the wall, how fast it was going, what type of weapon was used, was it a gun or a bat or a knife, how many blows occurred using cast-off spatter, was it disturbed, and if it was disturbed, how long after that blood stain was there was it then disturbed? Imagine what you can do with an entire crime scene. I will take you through all these concepts, and I will also give you a series of demonstrations. All right, let's get to it. So the first concept I want to talk about are the effects of surface texture on blood droplets. In general, the harder and less porous the surface is, the less spatter results, like smooth surfaces, like glass, for example. Rough surfaces, however, result in irregularly shaped stains with serrated edges sometimes called spines that kind of like radiate away out of the blood droplet. And you also have satellite spatter. Satellite spatter would be like the little droplets outside that kind of radiate away from those blood droplets, from the blood droplet. Now, some examples of surfaces that blood can land on is glass, hardwood flooring, carpet, tile, cloth, paper. Which of these do you suppose would result in less spatter, and which of these do you suppose would result in more spatter? Glass definitely would be on the less spatter side, whereas cloth and paper, that would be on the more spatter. Of course, hardwood flooring, tile, it depends on how smooth the surface is. But so let's do a little demo here, and we got glass, we got manila paper, we got paper towel, hardwood floor. All right, if you look, there's a little bit of spatter on the iPad, but definitely not nearly as much as on the manila paper. Look at the irregular surface, the irregular shape that was caused by the paper towel. And then you got the hardwood. There is a little bit of spatter, but it's clearly not as much as on the on that folder there, the manila folder. You kind of zoom in there, a little bit of satellite spatter. You don't see any spines because you have that blood droplet is very, very round in shape. But definitely a lot less spatter than like on the manila paper. And then you see the irregular shaped blood droplet that occurs on the paper towel there. Okay, next thing I want to talk about is the directionality of angle of impact. The direction of blood striking an object is determined by using the pattern that it makes. The pointed end, or you could say the tail, or you could say the disrupted edge, always faces the direction that it was traveling. When a blood droplet hits, let's say it's going from left to right, the tail then, or the disrupted edge, will be on the right-hand side because that's the direction it was traveling from left to right. So it'll be on the right-hand side. So here are a couple of blood droplets here that I just drew out. The one on the left-hand side, which direction do you suppose this was moving when it hit this sheet of paper? From top to bottom or bottom to top? Answer is from top to bottom, because you see that the very regular, a very nice smooth shape. It's just like imagine a water balloon, you know, a balloon filled with water. You hit it, it's going to make the first mark that it makes is going to be a very nice round. You can see like that circle or oval. The remaining will be, the disrupted edge then will be in the direction that it's traveling. All right, how about the one on the right-hand side there? This will be from, this blood drop was moving from right to left. The right side is very clean and regular. The left side has the disrupted edge, or you could say the tail. As stains increase in elliptical shape, the direction of impact becomes more discernible. It becomes more and more obvious as the circle becomes more and more and more oval. All right, what about dropping distance? As blood droplets fall further and further and further from the ground, do you suppose the diameter increases or decreases? Well, let's take a look. All right, so let's drop one. This is going to be from 1 foot. This one, 2 feet. Next one, I'm going to drop from 3 feet. Fourth one from 4 feet. Fifth one from 5 feet high. 6 feet high. Next one, 7 feet high. And finally, from 8 feet high. And you can even see it just like that. There's the eighth one. And you can even see it just even without measuring that they actually it's actually increasing. All right, so here is first one, second one, third one, fourth one from 4 feet, fifth one from 5 feet, sixth one from 7 feet high, and from 8 feet high. All right, let's take a tape. Now, I should be using metric, but I just don't have one at the moment, so but that's okay. We're just, this is good enough for our purposes here. All right, so this is 12 sixteenths of an inch in diameter, 13 sixteenths in diameter. That one's the same, 13 sixteenths. This one is 14 sixteenths, so I can already see the diameter is increasing. 14, that one's pretty much the same. The sixth one is, let's call it 15 sixteenths. The seventh one. So it's not much, but they are increasing in diameter as the height increases. So the answer is, it increases. The blood stain diameter increases as the height increases. So if you just do a little drawing here, diameter will increase as height increases. All right, what about the angle of impact? So the impact angle of blood on a flat surface can be determined by measuring the degree of circular distortion. All right, so let's pay attention here. So the formula that I need you to commit to memory is the sine of the angle is width divided by the length of the blood droplet. Now, we don't want the sine of the angle. We want the angle. We want to know at what angle. So how do we get rid of sine there? Well, we take the inverse sine of our number, which is the width divided by length, and that will give us the angle. So let's just draw a little diagram here just so we can see what we're talking about. Let's say the source of blood was up there, that little blue dot. What we're going to do is measure the length, the width and the length, and get ourselves that angle. At which angle, how high basically was that? So the first thing we want to do is you take the good edge, the undistorted edge, and you kind of get a feel for the curve. Then what we're gonna do is match that, because you have that disrupted edge. So you gotta kind of match it, and you just kind of draw in, of course, this blood stain has to be dry. And so you match the shape on the left-hand side with the distorted edge on the right-hand side. Once you've done that, then you can go ahead and measure your length and your width. So this is going to be the length. The length always should be longer than the width. So that's the length, and then the width will be the smaller of the two numbers. So let's put in here length. We'll put width on this side. Now let's do some math. Okay, so we have a real blood drop here. We find ourselves the undistorted edge. And here we have the tail, or the distorted edge. Make your way around. So we say, okay, we'll do the, remember, it's the width divided by height. So we got, see here, 1.75 centimeters. 1.75, so let's write that down. That's going to be our width now. Our width is 1.75 centimeters. Then we'll measure the length. One, two, let's just call it three, just to make it easy on ourselves. Just to, for this demonstration, that's just fine. All right, so 1.75 centimeters divided by 3 centimeters. So the sine of the angle is equal to the width divided by length, 1.75 divided by 3. Let's put that in our calculator. Divided by 3, that gives us 0.583. That number there is the sine of the angle. That's not the angle, that's the sine of the angle. So let's just write that down right here. So the inverse sine of our number, the width divided by length, gives us the angle. So all we have to do is, you can just tip your phone, you got your, put your number back in, 0.583, and that's sine right there. So if you hit second, now you got your inverse sine. Touch it, and 35.7 degrees. So this blood droplet hit the paper at 35.7 degrees, which is pretty sharp, but there you go. It's kind of low to the ground when it hit. 35.7 degrees. Again, the width has to be less than the length. The width has to be length. That number must be less than 1. That 0.583 number, it always has to be less than 1. If we put in 3 divided by 1.75, that'll give us a number greater than 1. Well, if we take the inverse sine of any number greater than 1, look what happens. It just doesn't work. It has to be less than 1. So that, remember, it's the width divided by the length. So again, 5.83, and then you take the inverse sine. Just touch the sine inverse there, 35 degrees. So 3 centimeters here, 1.75 centimeters here, width divided by length, and then you take the inverse sine. That's how you do it. Now, if we do a little drawing here, what does that actually mean? What does 35 do? Is it 35 degrees from the ground or 35 degrees from the wall? Well, the answer is it's from the ground. It's always from the ground. If I did this in green here, this angle is, would that be a big angle or a small angle? Well, it's, you measure from the ground. So this better be greater than 45 degrees. We'll call it 70 degrees. We always measure from the ground. And if I did another angle, let's see here, something like this, is that a really big angle? No, because we're not measuring from the wall, we're measuring from the ground. We'll call it 5 degrees. We always measure from the ground. Let's just write that just to make sure. We always measure from the ground. All right, so you take a look. This is, here's the ground here in blue. Let's just pretend this is the ground. Zero is actually not at the bottom of the protractor. It's actually up a little bit. So that's how you measure. 35.7 degrees. Let's do another one here. So again, the sine of the angle is width divided by length. Find your nice edge, and you try to match the same thing on the disrupted edge. Width here, we'll call it 1.5. This way, we'll call it 4. Again, the smaller number better be on top. 1.5 divided by 4 is 0.375. Then you just take the inverse sine. Remember, that's the sine of the angle. So the inverse sine of 0.375 gives us our angle. Put in the calculator. Second, hit second sine. There it is right there. Sine with a negative 1. 22 degrees. So this is even sharper. And you can tell because it's more elliptical. 22 degrees. So in real life, this is actually how you'd reconstruct. You take a string, you get your protractor, and you bring it up, 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 up until you hit 22 degrees. And on the other side of the string, you would put a pole, you tape it to your pole, and then you do it one after another, after you do it for every single blood droplet, until you can tell where the source of blood was and from where the blow actually occurred. See, the protractor, the bottom protractor is always in the way, so you gotta kinda... All right, very good. Here's another one, and I don't really see much distortion at all. I don't see much circular distortion. So what angle was this dropped from? Well, let's just measure here. It's 1.75, 1.75. Let's just write that down. So here's our little blood droplet, 1.75. That obviously gives us 1. Put in the calculator. Just do it just as proof. 1. So do the inverse sine of 1. There you go, 90 degrees. What does 90 mean? 90 means that gravity pulled it down with no other factors, no angle whatsoever, 90 degrees. All right, the next thing I want to talk about is the impact of bloodstain, impact bloodstain spatter patterns. So what is impact spatter? It's the pattern produced when an object makes forceful contact with a source of blood. Projecting drops outward from the source. And we have two kinds here. We have forward spatter. What is forward spatter? Well, it's spatter that keeps going in the same direction that caused the impact, as the force that caused the impact spatter. So if a baseball bat, say, hits you from the right-hand side, blood that goes out the left side is considered forward spatter. Back spatter is blood that's directed back towards the source of the force. So we did a little drawing here. We got a little dude here. Let's do a little gun bullet. Okay. So the direction is going towards the left now. We see towards the left of our paper. Okay. Source of blood. Well, forward spatter would continue going in the same direction. So these three blood drops would be forward spatter. Back spatter would go back towards the direction from which the impact came from. So that would be on the right side there. Forward spatter, back spatter. We also have classifications based on the velocity of blood droplets. A phenomenon here is, as the force of impact on the source of blood increases, the velocity of blood droplets leaving the source of blood also increases. So as the force increases, the velocity leaving also goes up. The speed also goes up. That kind of makes sense. However, as the force and velocity of the impact increase, actually the diameter of the blood drops actually decreases. The blood droplets get smaller and smaller and smaller as the hit becomes faster and faster and faster. Think a baseball bat versus a gunshot bullet, okay? So we got low velocity spatter. We have medium velocity spatter, and we have high velocity spatter. Well, what would cause low velocity? What do we consider low velocity? Well, gravity. Gravity we would just call low velocity. Let's put that here. Okay, medium. Say baseball bat or a knife, a samurai sword. Medium velocity. High velocity we would consider like a gunshot bullet. Okay, well, how fast are these things actually going? How fast? These don't have to be, you don't have to memorize these numbers, just in general. We're talking like less than 5 feet per second for low velocity. To be considered medium velocity, we'll say between 5 and 25 feet per second. And for high velocity, we consider anything greater than 100 feet per second, for sure we consider high velocity, like a gunshot bullet. Now, the numbers I do want you to know is, what are the resulting diameter sizes of the blood spatter? Well, remember, it's the opposite. So for low velocity, you actually have the greatest diameter. We actually have anything larger than 3 millimeters was considered low velocity spatter, like gravity. 1 to 3, medium velocity, and high velocity would result in blood spatter that's less than 1 millimeter. So let's say here we got a blood droplet. We measure, hopefully I drew it correctly, because let's see here, that's 1 centimeter. So that's, yes, remember there's 10 millimeters in 1 centimeter. Here we go. Let's use this guy. Eight millimeters. So yep, 2 millimeters and 1 millimeter. I mean, I drew them, I didn't actually, but there you have it. Gun spatter will always have the smallest because the force was fast and the velocity that leaves the source of blood will also be fast, resulting in very, very, very tiny droplets. It's kind of like the opposite of what you might think. Something to note here is that, remember, there's very little mass in those tiny, tiny, tiny blood droplets. Well, tiny mass means, very little mass means it won't go very far. So the more mass a droplet has, the further it can travel. Just, I mean, just think of, you scrunch up a paper versus, a baseball bat. How far can they go? So that means that a gunshot bullet spatter will always be very close. Wherever it lands, the gun must have been, or the source of blood must have been very, very, very close to the source of blood. Those droplets will always be very close to the source of blood with that high velocity gunshot spatter. All right, very good. All right, so we have two different phenomena that we use here for the origin of impact spatter. We have the area convergence and we have the area of origin. Area of convergence is where it's a two-dimensional plane. We draw lines. Basically, you take the blood droplets and you find the axis, the long side, and you draw lines through the blood droplets through all of them until you find a single point of origin, a single area of convergence. However, the area of origin is in 3D. You take the area of convergence, then you use the angles that we measured, and you bring the strings up until you actually have the actual point from which the blow took place. So you measure down the lines, down the axis. Of course, I just kind of drew these. These aren't actual blood droplets, so let me just fix this here. And that would be the area of convergence. To get the area of origin, then you take the angles and you take strings and you pull them up and you tape them onto a rod that's standing upright until you get the area of origin, which is in 3D. Okay? You take a string, you pull it up, now you got yourself, you tape it to a pole, now you got the area of origin, which is 3D. All right, so we have 10 or 12 different types of spatter. We got gunshot spatter. So this is, we talked about this before, forward and backward spatter. Remember, that was the high velocity spatter. But also we have something called the drawback effect, which is when the gun is close enough, when the muzzle is close enough, you get blood droplets in the actual muzzle of the weapon, of the gun, which is called the drawback effect. You can use this and tell how close the gun actually was to the person. You have cast off. Now, this is created when blood is flung from a blood-bearing object, like a knife or a baseball bat. And the size of the spatter is directly proportional to the point of the object. For example, a bat is very, very blunt. So what do you expect to get? Well, it's very blunt, so you're going to get larger drops. Whereas a knife or like a samurai sword is very sharp, so you're going to have smaller spatter. Let's take a look here. You can also determine the number of blows based on the number of cast off spatter. So let's say you have three. That you find at a crime scene. How many blows occurred with those three? Well, the first one is not going to bear any blood. So there's first blow, You swing back, and you have your first cast off. Then you have your second cast off, because you swung it again, and you have your second blow. Then you pull it back, you may swing back, and that's three cast off with only two blows. We can do it again. First blow, no spatter. Swing back, second cast off. Second blow with the third. So three cast off and two blows. So that person was hit two times. We also have arterial spray. This results in vertical arcs showing fluctuation in blood pressure. You get cut in the neck, you get cut in the brachial artery, you're going to get these arches like on the wall, for example. We also have expirated blood. This will be like, you know, from the nose, showing damage from the like lungs or the respiratory system. And these blood droplets are going to be very bright. Why? Because they're because of the air bubbles in the blood droplets. You can get very, very, very bright blood droplets. We also have void patterns. So you get all kinds of blood spatter all over the room. Well, if a door was open, you get an object that was in a way, or even a person that was in the way, you're going to get a void. You're going to have a space on the ground or on the wall where you're not going to have spatter, and then the person moves, or you shut the door and you see a big void. These are called void patterns. And this can help reconstruct the crime scene. You know, was the door open or was there someone standing there? We also have contact or transfer patterns. And this is when an object or a person with blood on themselves touches something without blood. It's called like a shoe, for example, like a shoe with blood. We also have a flow pattern, which is basically blood that's been pooled up, but because if the ground is not completely flat, it's going to sort of get pulled by gravity a little bit and causing like a little bit of a flow. And then you have a pool pattern, which is where you have a completely level ground and it just pools up. We also have drip and a drip trail pattern. So a drip pattern is just drop on top of a drop on top of a drop. Let's say someone is like hanging from the ceiling or some kind of source of blood is just not moving. You're just gonna drop on top of each other. However, a drip trail pattern is you get your arm is cut, someone's arm is cut and they're walking. Or someone is carrying a dead person that's bleeding, you're going to get this drip trail pattern. Finally, we got swipe and wipe. They sound very close. What's the difference? Well, a swipe is when you have, for example, on your hand, blood already on your hand or on someone's hand, the victim's hand or the perp's hand, and you hit the wall or you hit the ground. That's going to be a swipe. But a wipe is where blood that's already on the wall or on the floor gets smeared and causes a different type of pattern. So this is called a wipe. All right, so this here is cast off, like from a knife. And you can even see the direction. We have, what do you think? This is drip trail. This is a drip trail, and you can even see like the 90 degree. Here is this the drip pattern. You can even see the spines going around. Let's see if I can make some satellite spatter with the same thing, same idea. The drip. This is just called drip pattern. You can see the satellite spatter. Now, if I do this clean finger, is that a swipe or a wipe? That would be a wipe because there was nothing on my finger. However, if there is already blood on someone's body, it doesn't have to be hands, and you hit a wall or anything, that's called a swipe. That's the difference between the two. Now we also have something called skeletonization. Skeletonization. And if you look closely, you can see that the blood droplet's been disturbed, but you still see the blood droplet. The outside has dried, called skeletonization. That's because the outside is thinner than the inside. All right, so we got cast off, we got drip, we got the drip trail pattern. This is swipe. This is wipe. We also have, let's just put it here, skeletonization. And this usually occurs, you know, when a blood droplet's been sitting for at least 50 seconds. The outside has dried, and then it's been disturbed after that, and this helps us build, you know, reconstruct a crime scene. There it is. You kind of see it. And this is fake blood, so it's, you know, it's not as clear, but you can see that the blood droplet's still there. The outside edges have dried. And so you still see it even after it's been wiped. Contact or transfer, like shoe marks, for example. With that transfer. So that's about 10 to 12 different types of spatter patterns for you. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you picked up a thing or two. Study well, and we'll see you next time.